came back for the second service just to hear that again. Thank you, Julia and Ann, for calling us to worship this morning. In deep gratitude, we come to worship God. We recognize God as the source of all goodness. All good gifts come from the Spirit of God. Love, peace, joy, patience, kindness, goodness are all of God. We come with grateful hearts, not for things, but for who God is. We gather to show our gratitude in song and prayer. We gather to worship God. It's my privilege to welcome you to this hour of worship at Central Baptist Church, a church with 120 plus years of heritage and a bright future with the worship of God. Not through religion, but the worship of God. Theologian Richard Rohr says, religion prefers and protects the status quo, the supposedly wonderful past. Jesus strongly rejects the love of the past and private perfection that many of us seem to think that God is really back there somewhere in the good old days, instead of calling us out ahead to drop our nets and to come follow me. God said, I am, not I was. And God wants to be present with us today in this service of worship, calling us to become the people of God that God is calling us to be. We're so glad that you have chosen to worship with us today in this place, in this hour, where we know with certainty that the worship of God can change our very lives. Let's worship together. Miss Katie's not here today, so I would like to invite, if you want to come out, you can just kind of sit there in your pews, but if the children would like to come out, I'd like to share something with you this morning. You can just kind of plop down in the aisle. Don't get too close. We're going to kind of social distant children's sermon. You over here, get over there. Don't touch each other. Don't breathe on anybody. So, it is so nice to see you this morning. I brought some stuff with me, a big bag here. And I see this is working out very nicely for me because I see we all have brothers and sisters, right? And so, has anyone in your house ever gotten something and you didn't get something and you said, "Hey, that's not fair"? No. Oh, come on. This is church. You have to tell the truth. Anybody ever said, who said that's not fair at my house? The only honest person here. Okay, there you go. There you go. Yeah, we've all said that's not fair because somebody gets something and we want it. And you know what? Because y'all are here this morning, there's a story that Jesus told about fair and unfair, or what some people thought was unfair. And he said, some people went out to work. And some went out early in the morning, and some people went out later in the day, and some people went out at the very end of the day, and they got paid, and they all got the same thing. And the people that worked early in the morning said, "Hey," what did they say? "No fair." "No fair." "Hey, no fair." They got the same thing. You know what? If I promised y'all something for coming down here, and I said that everybody who was sitting on this side over here gets Brussels sprouts, and everybody who's sitting on this side gets candy, would that be fair?
No.
Oh, you were sitting on this side, right? That's why that wouldn't be fair. No, that wouldn't be fair. But what if I said, y'all come down here, and I have in this bag a bag for each of your parents. They'll give it to you after church. But inside of this, you think it's Brussels sprouts or candy? Candy, you hope it's candy, it's not Brussels sprouts. Yes, but if I said, thank you for coming down this morning, I want to share with all of you so that you will know that God is good and God loves to share with everyone all the same. Let's pray and thank God for that. God, we are so grateful that you are so good. We are so thankful that you share so abundantly with us. Please help us to share with others too. For it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Oh, Miss Nancy is going to take anybody that wants to go to Children's Church. She's waiting outside that door over there. So if y'all want to go that way, she would love to see you.
The scripture today is Psalm 78, 1 through 4, and 12 through 16. My people, hear my teaching. Listen to the words of my mouth. I will open my mouth with a parable. I will utter hidden things, things from of old, things we have heard and known, things our ancestors have told us. We will not hide them from their descendants. We will tell them the next generation, the praiseworthy deeds of the Lord, his power, and the wonders he has done. He did miracles in the sight of their ancestors in the land of Egypt, in the region of Zoan. He divided the sea and led them through. He made the water stand up like a wall. He guided them with the cloud by day and with light from the fire all night. He split the rocks in the wilderness and gave them water as abundant as the seas. He brought streams out of a rocky crag and made water flow like rivers.
Would you please stand for the reading of the litany, for the prayers of the people, and the Lord's Prayer? And would you please respond by reading the bold print in your worship folder? The world is filled with the glory of God, and we say, the hills and the valleys begin to fill with color, and we say, the vines and the trees are filled with fruit, and we say, our tables are overflowing with food, and we say, our life is filled with love of family and friends, and we say, we fill this house of God with our voices saying, may the words of our mouths and the meditation of our hearts be acceptable to you, O God, as we offer our praise, our thanksgiving, and our prayers. And now let us pray. In the midst of our thanksgiving, let us pause in silence to recall how we so often lose sight of the gifts of each day and of their giver. O God, forgive us when we forget to love you, when we forget to help our neighbors, when we forget to thank you. Grant us clear minds to know you, O God, renewed hearts to love you, strong hands to serve you. Help us live this day, this week, and always, so that our whole life is a thanksgiving to you. And now we pray as Christ taught us, saying, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Circumstances make perfect sense to us as we try to understand each move he makes. When the path grows dim and our questions have no answers, look to him. Trust the heart of your Father when the answer goes beyond what you can see. Bow the knee, lift your eyes toward heaven and believe the one who holds eternity. And when you don't understand,
Thank you, Tim, for leading us so well in both services this morning. Message text today comes from the Old Testament prophet Ezekiel, chapter 18. I'll read the first four verses and then we'll skip ahead to verse 25. Listen, please, for a word from God to you as we hear sacred scripture together. The word of the Lord came to me. What do you mean by repeating this proverb concerning the land of Israel? The parents have eaten sour grapes, and the children's teeth are set on edge. As I live, says the Lord God, this proverb shall no more be used by you in Israel. Know that all lives are mine. The life of the parent as well as the life of the child is mine. It is only the person who sins that shall die. Yet you say, the way of the Lord is unfair. Hear now, O house of Israel, is my way unfair? Is it not your ways that are unfair? When the righteous turn away from their righteousness and commit iniquity, they shall die for it. For the iniquity that they have committed, they shall die. Again, when the wicked turn away from the wickedness they have committed and do what is lawful and right, they shall save their life. Because they considered and turned away from all the transgressions that they had committed, they shall surely live, they shall not die. Yet the house of Israel says, the way of the Lord is unfair. O house of Israel, are my ways unfair? Is it not your ways that are unfair? Therefore I will judge you, O house of Israel, all of you according to your ways, says the Lord God. Repent and turn from all your transgressions, otherwise iniquity will be your ruin. Cast away from you all the transgressions that you have committed against me, and get yourselves a new heart and a new spirit. Repent. Why will you die, O house of Israel? for I have no pleasure in the death of anyone, says the Lord God. Turn then and live. The word of God for the people of God, and we say, thanks be to God. As Steve taught our children, the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 20, Jesus tells a story about a landowner, a farmer, who needs some extra workers around the farm during the harvest. He hires day laborers to work in his fields. He hires the first round of laborers at dawn. And then halfway through the morning, he hires some more to work for the day. And then after lunch, the landowner, the farmer, hires even more workers. At the end of the day, the farmer pays the first group who have been working since dawn what they had all agreed to work for the day, and everyone is happy. And then the farmer pays the second group who have been working since mid-morning, but he pays them the exact same thing he paid the first group. And the first group starts to scratch their heads a little bit. And then the landowner pays the third group. They didn't start working until after lunch, and he pays them the exact same thing. And the first group says, that's not fair. I have a friend who spent about a year working for a cabinet shop in Atlanta. My friend wasn't a carpenter himself. His job was to oversee the installation of the cabinets and new homes or renovations scattered all over the city. To make sure that the cabinets got from the shop to the job site safely and on time, and then that they got installed properly and without damage, and that everyone was happy when they left at the end of the day. So most mornings he would start by loading up tens of thousands of dollars worth of cabinets into a big box truck to get them ready for delivery. And very often the cabinet shop would need to hire some extra workers to get the job done. So my friend would stop by a gas station parking lot on his way to the job site and hire some day laborers. Over time, he learned that day laborers are not all created equal. Some were really strong. And that came in really handy when you were trying to carry heavy cabinets up steep stairs and around tight corners. Some spoke pretty good English, and you always needed at least one worker who could communicate both with you and with the rest of the crew. So that came in handy too. Some had their own tools and knew how to use them. Some came with pretty well-developed carpentry skills, and of course that was valuable as well. My friend would pay the day laborers cash at the end of each day. And eventually, he realized that some of these more skilled day laborers, whom he discovered you needed to pay a little bit more to get them reliably, he discovered that if they worked a particularly long day that day, some of these skilled laborers who made a little bit extra per hour would end up making more money that day than he did. My friend was the one who hired them. He was the one the company trusted with tens of thousands of dollars worth of cabinets. He was the one responsible for making sure that it was installed correctly and that the homeowners and the other contractors were pleased with the work. And he worked longer hours. Yet in some instances, the laborers were making more than he was. And he said, that's not fair. He didn't stay at that job for very much longer after that. The prophet Ezekiel, our Old Testament prophet for the day, lives at the intersection of three great empires: the Assyrian Empire, the Babylonian Empire, and the Egyptian Empire. And as part of our Wednesday midweek devotional this week, maybe some of you have seen it, I talked about how Ezekiel, a towering figure in our Old Testament, a leading Old Testament prophet, we talked about how Ezekiel fits into that much larger context of history. The truth is that in the story of Babylon, Ezekiel is a prophet of the Babylonian exile. In the story of Babylon and in Babylon's great king, Nebuchadnezzar, Ezekiel is hardly even worth mentioning. No one in Babylon would even know who Ezekiel is. Egypt, too, was vying for control of Israel at the time. Much of Ezekiel's prophecy is directed toward Egypt's efforts to take over the Promised Land. But in the great volumes of history written about Egypt, nary a word about our prophet Ezekiel. Same with Assyria, by the way. Much of Ezekiel's prophecy is characterized by visions, often very, very strange visions. And Ezekiel's visions of palaces and throne rooms are so often so similar to some of the great Assyrian palaces of history that scholars think that Ezekiel must have traveled to Nineveh himself to see those palaces in person. But no one in Assyria would know who Ezekiel is. Even today, among the major prophets, Isaiah, Jeremiah, Ezekiel is surely the least accessible and least well known. Ezekiel's visions and prophecies are strange, and they're hard to understand, and his language is very often harsh and violent. He really is less accessible than some of our other prophets. Most of us are more familiar with the rock band Journey singing about wheels in the sky than we are about prophet Ezekiel's visions of wheels in the sky, from which the band gets the song. Others of us, I think, are probably more able to quote Ezekiel, if we even know that's where it's from, more because we're fans of the movie Pulp Fiction than because we're close readers of the biblical text. The path of the righteous man is beset on all sides by the iniquities of the selfish and the tyrannies of evil men, Ezekiel 25:17. If hitman Jules Winfield began to quote Ezekiel to you in Pulp Fiction, you knew you were about to die. So if Ezekiel the prophet is largely inconsequential in the histories of the great empires he happened to live at the intersection of, and if most of Ezekiel proves to be largely inaccessible to modern readers, so much so, by the way, that we get more Ezekiel from 80s rock bands and 90s blockbuster movies than we do from Bible study, then why does Ezekiel continue to hold such a prominent place in our scriptures? Well, our passage for today points to at least one answer. 600 years before Christ, that's when Ezekiel is writing. 600 years before Christ, Ezekiel in his prophecy gets at an issue that is still a central question in our understanding of who God is. And it's the issue of justice. The issue of fairness and grace and generosity. Ezekiel says in our passage to the Israelites, "For the longest time you have heard it said that children will suffer for the sins of their fathers. The parents have eaten sour grapes, and yet it's the children's teeth who are set on edge. And you say that's not fair." And to people facing exile, it really wasn't. To hear that the challenges and hardships that they were enduring or that they would endure, to hear that all of that was the result of the sins of a previous generation, of course they said that's not fair. Why should we be responsible for what they did? So Ezekiel says, you will no longer hear that proverb said in Israel. From this day forward, each of you will be responsible only for yourselves. The wicked will perish, and the righteous shall live. That sounds more fair. But, Ezekiel says, because God is gracious and generous, even the wicked, if they turn from their sin, will be saved. And the people say, well, That's not fair. I've been good my whole life. Ezekiel gives examples of righteous and unrighteous behavior. He says, don't eat food that's been sacrificed to idols. If you do that, you will surely die. Don't commit adultery with your neighbor's wife, and you will live. These are righteous things to do, Ezekiel says. Do them or don't do them, and you will live. And the people said, well, that sounds pretty fair. But then the prophet continues. And don't take advantage of the poor in their distress. Don't charge them interest. And don't take as collateral what they need to survive in exchange for a loan. Give their pledge back to them. People said, well, that's starting to sound a little bit like special treatment. I thought we were talking about fairness. Prophet continues, give your food to the hungry and your clothes to people who have nothing to wear. If you have more than enough while others have less than they need, it's like you're stealing from them. People said, well, that really doesn't sound fair at all. What responsibility of mine are they? Prophecy is disruptive. It points at our blind spots. And Ezekiel's prophecy reminds us that the cry of God's people for all time is and has been, let us persist in our sin without punishment. Let us just do what we think is fair. We don't believe that what God thinks is wrong is really all that wrong. Let us persist. That's why repentance, which Ezekiel calls for twice in the passage we've read, that's why repentance requires a change of mind, as I so often remind you. Because we don't very often think that what God thinks is fair or is unfair is unfair. We don't believe that being indifferent to the poor is actually wrong. Not in the same way that we believe adultery is wrong. Not in the way that we believe that armed robbery is wrong. Because our standard is one of fairness. But God's standard is a standard of generosity. That's why we so often find ourselves shouting, that's not fair, at God, because we operate by different standards far too often. Our standard is one of fairness, but God calls us to a standard of generosity. Our inclination, mine included, by the way, is to ask, what's the least I can responsibly do and still meet the standard of righteousness? God's inclination is to ask, what's the most? And Ezekiel asks, is it God's way that is unjust? Or is it yours? Prophecy is disruptive. 2 summers ago now, I preached a series on the Sermon on the Mount. One sermon in the series was titled, Be Generous, is based on the turn the other cheek text from Matthew chapter 5. If someone strikes you on one cheek, turn to them the other also. If someone asks you for your coat, give them your shirt as well. If someone asks you to go 1 mile, go the second mile with them. Be generous. And I said then, that in every situation, we ought to ask ourselves, what is the most generous thing I can responsibly do? Not what's the fairest thing. What's the most generous thing I can responsibly do in this situation? And by the way, very often, responsibility to ourselves and to our families and to our others places appropriate restraint on generosity. But generosity ought to always be our aim, not fairness. Church member Pat McKee has a new book out, his debut novel called Ariel's Island. It's a legal thriller. I don't think he'll mind me telling this story. A few months ago, he spoke next door at the Carnegie Library as part of their author's series, and Pat's book raises some questions about the rise of technology and artificial intelligence as more and more advanced computers have more and more influence over our lives. Some days I feel like all I have to do is say the word toothpaste out loud in front of my phone, and I'll have advertisements for Colgate and Crest follow me around for months. There are, of course, significant ethical and moral questions that come with the rise of artificial intelligence. As technology becomes smarter and smarter, shouldn't we invest it with some kind of ethical grounding? Some kind of moral baseline to guide it? And if so, what is it? What is that moral baseline? Pat asked that question as part of the discussion surrounding his book at the Carnegie Library a few weeks ago. And so I raised my hand and asked Pat, I said, "You've written the book. You've obviously thought about this more than the rest of us in this room. What do you think the answer is? If we were going to find a way to code morality into machines, what would we code into them?" And Pat, a faithful deacon at Central Baptist Church, gave Jesus' answer. He said, it's the two great commandments about love. Love God and love your neighbor as yourself. That's what we should do. We chuckled at the time, by the way, about the fact that in the Bible, it's a lawyer asking a preacher the question, and at the Carnegie Library, it was a preacher asking the lawyer the question. We came to the same answer. Pat, of course, gives the right answer, but I went home and thought about that question all afternoon. And setting Pat's answer aside, I think I would say this. If we had to code a moral baseline into artificial intelligence, or if we could code a moral baseline into each one of us, I might want it to be this. What's the most generous thing I can do in this situation? Since Eve first ate the apple and gave it to Adam, and Eve said, "The devil made me do it," and Adam said, "The woman made me do it," the cry of humanity has been, "That's not fair." Let us persist in our sin without consequence. But what if we shifted our baseline from fairness to God's baseline of generosity? What if we stopped being offended by a perceived lack of fairness and instead had our moral sensibilities pricked every time we saw a lack of generosity? What if children everywhere, and adults too, stopped crying, "That's not fair, that's not fair," and instead started living by a different standard? Crying, "That's not generous. That's not generous." Would you join me in prayer? Heavenly Father, as we gather this morning, the prophet reminds us that far too often the standards by which we live are misaligned with the standards you would have guide us. Even as we seek fairness, help us to aim for generosity. Make us people who are generous. More specifically, make us people who are generous to others as you have been generous to us. Make our lives living examples of grace. Of the grace that is ours in Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, in whose name we pray. Amen. Every week at Central, we give you an opportunity to give. Giving is an act of worship. And as an act of worship, giving reminds all of us that all of who we are and all of what we have belongs to God. At the conclusion of our worship service today, you will have the opportunity to give by dropping your offering and offering plates at the exits or right here at the front of the sanctuary. Your generous gifts today will sustain and support the ongoing ministries of this church and the growth and ministry of God's kingdom all over the world. Would you bow with me in prayer? Heavenly Father, we strive for generosity in all that we do, including in our giving. Bless our gifts this morning, and bless us as we give them. In Jesus' name, amen.
And now would you stand for our benediction? Go from this place with joy, giving thanks to God, proclaiming God's goodness and celebrating his love, worshiping God with all your lives, and go from this place to be a people of generosity, of hope and compassion. May the blessing of God, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with you this week and days to come. Amen.